Hey guys, Dr. J here. And in this video, we're going to continue our discussion of weather and weather related to UAV flights and performance. And in this video, we'll talk about clouds and fog. Clouds and fog are very related. They're almost the same thing, except clouds are high up and fog is on the ground. But they are very closely related, and the same general types of processes form them both. Now, in order to understand clouds and fog, we need to understand a little bit about how they form. And the dew point is the temperature to which air needs to be cooled in order to be saturated. So if I can draw a little diagram here. So if we have a graph where we have water vapor, H2O, in the air, and this is going to be water that is actually vapor, so gas, H2O, and then we'll have temperature. And the basic idea here is that at higher temperatures, the maximum amount of water vapor that the air can hold is going to be higher. And at lower temperatures, the maximum amount of water vapor the air can hold will be lower. So we'll be sort of in this vicinity where there can be less water vapor in the air than is the maximum that it can hold, but it can never be over that, right? So we have to be down here beneath this line. Now, you can imagine if we're at a high temperature, we've got a lot of water vapor in the air, maybe it's a hot, humid summer day somewhere up here, and then the air temperature cools, let's say at night when the sun goes down, the air temperature is going to cool, so the temperature is going to go this way, and that's going to put us into this above-the-line area. And what that means is we can't be over there, and so instead of doing that, we'll go to the line, and that is going to be our dew point. Our dew point is the temperature at which air needs to be cooled in order to be saturated. And so right here at this point, this is no good. We can't cross that line because the air can't hold that much water vapor when it's only this temperature. And so at this point, and then what we might do is kind of travel along the line as the temperature continues to cool. What happens to all that water vapor in the air when that temperature cools down? That's going to be condensing out as dew or as fog or as clouds. All of those things are a result of this same process. Air cooling down gets too much moisture in it, and so the water vapor precipitates out as liquid water, tiny water droplets. So the dew point is going to be reported in our weather reports, our METARs, and it will be reported in weather services reports like the ATIS. And the dew point and when the dew point and the temperature are close to each other, that's when you're going to be having fog and clouds and rain, etc. Just a quick note that frost is actually the same thing as dew, except it's when the dew point is below freezing, and so we get frost instead of dew. Now, how does air reach saturation? Now, I mentioned it, the same basic process is operating in all cases. It's warm, moist air that's cooling down, but there are various ways that this happens. One way is for a warm air mass to move over a cold surface, for example. That's number one there. Another way is for cold and warm air masses to collide, and this happens in fronts. We're going to talk about fronts in another video. A warm air mass might be caught at night and cool down. That happens a lot in Missouri, where you have hills and valleys, and a warm air mass might get caught down in a valley. It cools down at night, and then that results in a fog in the valleys. And then finally, we might have a warm air mass that's being lifted up and cooled down, such as in mountainous country where you have warm, moist air being moved up a slope. And there's actually a name or names for different types of fog. We've got advection fog, radiation fog, steam fog, upslope fog. So let's talk about what these types of fog are. Now, you might say, well, why do I need to know all the details about the different types of fog? Fog is fog, right? Well, actually, this is important to know because it's important to know what kind of fog you may encounter as a pilot. But it's also important to know because these are going to be on your Part 107 knowledge exam. So you definitely want to be able to understand these different types of fog and be able to recall how they're different and similar to each other. So let's talk about advection fog. Advection fog is typically going to be in coastal areas or areas where warm, moist air has the ability to move into cooler areas. And wind is required for this. So think movement. Advection, for those of you who are in science, advection is often associated with the movement of material or movement of something. And so advection means movement. And this is a warm, moist air that gets advected or moved from somewhere where it was warmer to a place, a cooler surface. And that results in fog forming, cools the air mass down and results in fog. Radiation fog is when warm, moist air gets caught in a cool valley and the air cools down. So this is when you have a warm air mass and sun goes down and that air mass cools down and that results in fog. Now, in this case, we have little to no wind, as opposed to the advection fog where we needed wind to move our warm air mass from one place to another. In this case, radiation fog is going to be related to very little wind. The air mass is radiating heat. I guess you can relate it to radiation in that way. Heat from the sun is going to burn off the fog. It's going to warm the air up, and that's going to allow the moisture that's in the air as little water droplets to re-vaporize and go back into the air as humidity. And if you have below freezing temps, then you'll get ice fog. So radiation fog is going to be no wind, warm, moist air mass that gets cooled down. Steam fog is the movement of cool air over a warm surface, and in particular, warm water. So if you have warm water, such as in the wintertime, maybe you have a lake which has been absorbing heat during the day, and then you have a cool air mass moving over that lake, you might get steam fog. And so just think about this as like a boiling pot of water. So in the boiling pot of water, the water is warm, the air is relatively cool compared to the boiling pot of water, and so you have steam coming out of that pot. This is steam fog. Or this is the same way that steam fog works. So warm water, cool air that gets displaced over the body of water, and then you get fog. And again, you can get icing during cold conditions with any of these types of fog. Upslope fog is when warm, moist air moves up a mountain slope. So I mentioned this before. In mountainous areas, you might have a wind which moves a warm air mass upslope, and that cools down the air. And these can be actually very transient. Those of you who live or are in mountainous areas a lot, you'll know that weather in mountainous areas can change a lot. There's a lot of turbulence in mountainous areas, and that can change the weather conditions very quickly. And upslope fog is no different. So upslope fog might last for only a few minutes, but it's this warmer mass that gets pushed upslope by a wind and cools down, precipitating out or condensing out water into little tiny droplets that form the fog, and that's our upslope fog. So here's just a table comparing these different types of fog. And again, the key thing that you'll want to remember is the different basic characteristics. So no wind is associated with radiation fog, and wind needs to be associated with advection fog, and also upslope fog, because those are warm air masses that are getting moved from one place to another. Steam fog is cool air over warm water. Think the boiling pot. Now, clouds are also same thing as fog, except they're up in the air, but they're basically the same idea. The air cools down, little droplets of water form in the air, and those are our clouds. Water droplets condense out of the air from the humidity as air cools, and you get clouds. Now, clouds are just a lot of fun for me because they come in all sorts of shapes and sizes, different types of clouds. We have cirriform clouds, which means cirrus, or cirro means hair. And so these are very high, wispy clouds. Cumulo-type clouds look like giant cotton balls, or they're very puffy. Stratiform clouds are layered clouds. And in fact, today in Missouri, we've got a lot of stratus clouds that are very flat and layered. We kind of have some wet, drizzly weather. And then nimboform clouds are rainy clouds, essentially, dark clouds. This is your rainy day type clouds. But it goes on. Clouds, there's a lot of different names for different types of clouds and even different elevations of clouds. So we have high clouds, and those are all of our cirrus clouds, regular cirrus clouds, our wispy clouds. We also have cirrocumulus clouds, which are very high, puffy clouds. These actually look like fish scales in the sky, so you can remember that. Cirrostratus clouds are our layered clouds that are high up in the air. We've also got altostratus clouds, which are kind of middle elevation clouds. And when I say low, middle, and high, these are a little bit relative, but sort of think maybe a few thousand feet high for the low level, maybe a few thousand feet up to a few miles for the middle level, and a few miles to up to 10 miles, the top of the troposphere, for the high level. Okay, so I've said our cirrus, our high clouds, our alto clouds are kind of the middle elevation clouds, so we can have alto stratus or alto cumulus. We can also have stratus clouds, those are low down, layered clouds, stratocumulus clouds, cumulus clouds, and our nimbostratus clouds are all going to be tend to be at lower elevations. And then we've got our cumulonimbus clouds. These are thunderstorm clouds, and these actually reach through all the different layers. In fact, cumulonimbus clouds actually tend to start as cumulus clouds and develop vertically until they've reached up into the atmosphere. And we'll talk a lot more about that in another video. Here's just another plot which sort of helps you get an idea of how high these things are. Again, our lowermost clouds are up to maybe a few thousand feet, maybe a mile or so. Our middle-level clouds are from, let's say, a mile to a couple of miles, 2-3 miles. And then our high-level clouds are going to be from that 2-3 mile, maybe here we have about 4 miles, up above to, you know, however high the troposphere is going. You'll notice that the height of the troposphere will be different in different regions. So the polar region is a little bit less. The atmosphere is thinner in polar regions, and the atmosphere is much thicker in tropical regions. And this actually has a lot of interesting implications for science and weather and climate. I study satellites and radar satellite images of the ground, and we have a lot more difficulty correcting for the tropospheric effects in our satellite images when we're at low latitudes near the tropics than we do when we're at temperate latitudes or polar latitudes. So pretty interesting that the height of the troposphere changes as you go from polar regions to the equator regions. And then one final type of cloud I'll mention, because they're kind of unique. These are occurring only in mountainous areas. These are lenticular clouds. And these are actually famous or infamous for being confused with UFOs. So these clouds have often been reported as UFOs by people who see them and don't understand what they are. But these are good indications of turbulence. So you have mountainous areas, you've got air that's sort of moving up and over the mountain, and just a very distinct type of cloud. Very cool and very easy to notice. Cloud ceiling. So cloud ceiling is just the height of the clouds. This is going to be related to cloud coverage. So I'm going to go ahead and just put up the rest of these, the rest of the slide here. So our cloud coverage is going to be reported, and you'll see these three-letter designations, CLR, SKC, that's going to mean little to no clouds. Few means few clouds, 1/8 to 2/8. Scattered, SCT, that's going to be 3/8 to 4/8. Broken, BKN, that's about 3/4. Covered, and then OVC, overcast, is fully covered. So today in Rolla, we have fully overcast skies, 8 out of 8. We would see OVC on our METAR or on our weather report. Now, what's going to happen is, if you have broken or overcast conditions, there's going to be a cloud ceiling reported. So broken and overcast conditions are associated with a ceiling, and that's basically just the height of the cloud. So if you're completely overcast, how high are those clouds that are overcasting the whole sky? That's what your cloud ceiling is. But as I said, only broken and overcast are going to be associated with a ceiling. If you have scattered clouds or few clouds, there won't be a ceiling reported. Visibility is also going to be something that gets reported. That's the greatest distance at which prominent objects can be viewed with the naked eye. You guys know what visibility is. It's how far you can see. And this is going to be reported in statute miles. The maximum is 10, so they won't report anything bigger than 10 statute miles, but it can be as low as 1/4. And remember that a visibility of 3 statute miles is legally required for drone operations. For UAV operations, you're required to be able to see 3 statute miles. And so if you look at your METAR for your local area and it says visibility is 2 statute miles or 1 statute mile, you're not going to be able to go out and fly. All right, so we've talked about different types of clouds. Clouds and fog occur when warm, moist air cools down to that dew point. Different types of fog occur under specific conditions. Different clouds occur at different elevations and are often signs of turbulence. So the end goal, of course, is to identify which days are going to be good for flying, which days are not, and you can use that information from the weather and from the weather reports, which we'll talk about in another video, to help you identify those things.